So yesterday we discussed about polymorphism, right? So what is polymorphism, method overloading, method overriding? So we discussed these topics yesterday. I hope you are clear about inheritance and polymorphism. Am I true? Any questions on polymorphism and inheritance, guys?
No, sir.
Yeah, good. Okay. Today I'm going to start with encapsulation. Okay. Before going to explain encapsulation, high level diagram yesterday I promised it, right? So overview of the OOPs concepts I will explain today. Okay, so let me start. If you try to see in this diagram, just have a look for 1 minute. Are you able to understand? Are you have any confusion? Try to see. Here, overall OOPs is nothing but object-oriented programming, right? So inside the object-oriented programming, we are containing everything. We'll talk about objects, right? Basically, object is nothing but a student, a car, a man, anything, an employee, an organization. Everything will talk about objects. Each object has some contain a properties and behavior. Properties and behavior is nothing but properties is nothing but a fields or a variables. Okay, behavior is nothing but the functionality. Okay, car is moving. A student, as a student, when I say student, a student is going to college. So this some type of functionality we are talking about. This is nothing but a methods. So object contain properties and methods. But in the real time, if you want to create an object, how we will create? We are created by using the class. So class is a logical entity. If you try to see inside your object, we are creating your class. Okay. By using the class, you can create any number of objects, right? I say object is a instance of a class so that you can create any number of objects in this way. Is it clear up to this flow? OOPs, objects, and class, and here. Again, when I say class, class contain what? A variables and methods. Variables is nothing but properties. Methods is nothing but behavior. Is it clear up to now? Left hand side. Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay. And again, inside the class, and again, when I come to the OOPs concepts, we have contained data structures, predefined data structures. Okay. Grouping primitive values and objects. It is divided into arrays and collections. Okay. Collections is an advanced topic, whereas arrays is a previous version. Basically, in the array, you can hold homogeneous type of elements like all primitive values, all string values, or user defined values. Anything we'll talk about the array. Due to the drawback of the array, okay, they introduce a lot of collections. Okay, this is predefined data structures will be available. It will hold homogeneous plus heterogeneous both functionality we can do in the collection. That is the overall the OOPs concepts. If you talk about the class contain, okay, arrays, and as soon as you can get the collections also. This is the overall diagram, how object, class, data structures, arrays are linked together. Is it clear this diagram? Any question?
Clear, sir.
Clear. Okay. Then let me go for encapsulation. Okay. What is an encapsulation? Any idea, guys?
It's something like we are hiding the logic from the actual user.
Okay. Any other inputs? Main point will be there. Encapsulation means. Mohammed, Rahul. One more guy is missing. One more Mohammed, right?
Okay. Yeah, Akram is not there.
Akram, yes. Okay. Okay. Basically, encapsulation is nothing but what you said is correct. And the main point is security. By using encapsulation, we are providing a security mechanism. Indirectly, if you want to implement encapsulation, is nothing but a data hiding from the user. How we are doing data hiding means that is the process of encapsulation design. Okay, in every project without encapsulation, there is no project at all. Okay, hope you have all model classes in your project dot model package. All your POJO classes will be there. Is nothing but plain old Java objects. Inside your encapsulation, all your setter method, getter methods, private fields, all related attributes will be there inside in your one package in your project. Okay, let me try to see. Now that concept only I'm explaining here. Okay, encapsulation means a wrapping of data as a single unit to protect the code from outside the class. Okay, this is a common definition. Even you can find in the Google also, no problem. In very granular level I'm giving, try to see. The process of defining a class, assume that a student class or a bank class or employee class, anything, hiding its data. Hiding its data is nothing but, variables, nothing but attributes of your bank. Bank attributes, what are the things we have? You can say customer name, account number, what is the main balance. These are the attributes of your bank, right? So from direct access from outside the class members, that means outside the user, direct access I can't provide. Suppose I have a balance, I have a balance attribute. Suppose when you click the ATM, directly you are able to see the balance, or you are doing some authentication, you are doing some PIN, then only you are doing, after authentication only you are able to see your balance, right? So this type of logic authentication you can provide through encapsulation. Okay, providing its access only through publicly accessible setter and getter methods with proper validation and authentication is called encapsulation. Very granular level, this is the definition. Okay, to make it very clear, I will show you a best example so that you will have a better idea. Okay, now how we can develop encapsulation in Java. Okay, in Java, encapsulation is implemented. Two rules you need to follow. Any idea? Guys, any idea? What are the two rules I need to follow?
No.
Okay, no problem. Okay, we need to follow by declaring variables as a private. Whatever you are defining inside your POJO class, your employee class or student class, all fields should be a private to restrict from direct access. We have a modifier, accessibility modifiers. Public keyword means you can access anywhere. Private means within the class you can access. Outside the class you cannot access at all. That is the importance of the private keyword. Okay, and by defining one pair of a public setter and getter method to access private variables. If you want to access these variables, you need to access through a instance methods. We have a setter and getter methods. You no need to write directly ID itself. If you generate, it will generate for you. Assume that in your real-time project implementation, if you take any POJO class, at least 10 attributes or 5 to 10 attributes will be there. For each attribute, you need to generate your setter and getter methods. If you want to do as a developer, at least it will take 10 to 15 minutes to write the code. But IDE, it's very smart enough, it will generate for you. Just you need to use where you need to generate. Okay, I will show you how you need to generate also. Okay, next. So that we declaring variables as a private to stop accessing them directly from outside the class. So that if I do that, so directly user cannot access the variable. Then if we given the access, what will happen? Okay, we'll see that point. We define a public methods to access the same variable from outside the class with proper validation, because if we provide a variable access directly, assume that I don't have this concept, okay, then I cannot validate the data before storing into the variable. Now assume that double balance is equal to 5000 I given. Maybe I'm taking some input from the scanner class. Directly, whenever you are giving as a 5000, it will be directly stored into a variable. Before storing into a variable, I want to provide some a logic for that balance. If I want to do those type of access, you need encapsulation design. Okay, let me go for a few examples so that you will have a better clarity. Okay, what I will do? Try to see here. Here, I have a class. Okay, I have a variable int x. Assume that this is my class. Now I have I don't have a private modifier. I can access this variable outside the class, right? Am I true?
Yes.
Okay. Now try to see this example. Are you able to understand this example? Anything is new here?
Just understand where the value of x will be changed.
Yeah. Now I'm giving directly. I'm giving as a 50, and directly I'm giving as a minus 10. Suppose as a customer, initially I need requirement in this way. So we've given the project now to the customer. Now after that, user try to give negative values, negative numbers they are trying to give. Then again, customer came, our input is accepting even negative values. I need a proper validation. Then how you will do the validation for specific to this variable? We cannot do. Maybe after storing the value, then here we will check, okay, if you can write a dot x value, it should not be, it should be less than zero. You need to those type of logic inside your main method. If you do the real time in this way implementation, the code will be keep on changing. Wherever you are using, it will be change. It will be reflect for other classes also. So instead of doing that part, I don't want to disturb my current classes, but I want to change my the code. It should be extendable in the future. If any new attributes came, then without reflecting with existing code, I want to change. Now try to see here. Now easily I can provide my validation as a 50. I can give as a minus 10. Both this value is accepting 50. I mean positive numbers plus your negative numbers also. Okay, you are able to see without encapsulation. This is without encapsulation. Now if I try to change with encapsulation, how we can write the logic? Try to see here. Okay. Now try to see here. How I can do that? What I will do? I will, for you to make it understand for you, let me take a small class. How you need to generate setter and getter methods, I will explain you. Okay. Now here I'm taking as a employee. Okay. Inside this employee, what are the common attributes will be there? Tell me, guys.
ID.
ID. Okay, good. Int ID. I'm giving some ID. Okay.
Name.
You can say first name, and you can say a last name. Okay. As of now, these three fields I have. Okay. Now if you want to provide encapsulation, you need to give us a private modifier. Okay. In this way. This is the first step if you want to do an encapsulation. Okay. Now I need to generate setter and getter method. Try to see in the Eclipse, go for the source tab. Here you can see there is a generate setter and getter methods. Okay. Click select all. If you need only the getters or only the setters, you can choose. As of now, I need both. Now I need to generate now. See. All code is generated now. Now, try to see now. Are you able to get to know, right? Up to now, is it clear?
Yes.
Okay. Now let me go for previous example. Where is our?
So here, can you go to previous
yes,
program?
yes, yes. Go ahead.
So here we are declaring the variables as a private.
Okay.
Yes, we are creating this method for the public. We are declaring same as the public, right?
Yes. For this ID, one setting method, one getting, one setter, one getter. Even for the first name, one setter and one getter. For each field has two methods. One you need to set the value, one you need to fetch the value. Okay?
Got it.
Yeah. Why I need to do in that way? Now in this example, you will have a better clarity. Now, just I have a field. I generated one setter method, one getter method. Try to see here. Whenever user is sending some value, suppose int a, assume that I pass my positive number. Here I'm doing some validation logic here. Before storing my value into a. Okay, by default, what is the default value of a?
Zero
will be there. Now as a user, he is providing some input as 100. Now you can do the logic, try to see. If your 100 is greater than zero, then you can initialize your value. This dot a is nothing but a current class object. That nothing but int a, it will be refer. Now you are storing your int a local variable into a class level variable. Now this is fine, no problem at all. Assume that. Okay, now your updated value will be 100. Now assume that as a user, okay, is 100. While you are fetching, what value I will get now?
100
you will get it now. Okay, this is a instance variable specific to example. Now second time I'm giving some minus value, -5 I given now. Okay, your a value will be still your 100. Now here you can do as a proper logic, this condition is failed, you will get do not pass negative numbers. You can give a proper message to the user, hey, you should not pass any negative numbers, and it will throw an exception. If you try to fetch still your get a, your updated value will be 100. It should not be 5. Is it clear?
Yeah.
Okay, now try to see the test class here. Is there any exception here? Is it everything is good, this program?
So first line, did you maybe error a direct access?
Yes, exactly. That is one I'm expecting, yes. Why? Because I've given as a private, right? So you should not access the values. Now try to see, here I'm posting a positive number. I'm fetching my value. Here also I'm posting positive number. I'm fetching my value. Let me see here. 56, 66. Now if I try to pass some negative value here.
If I create a,
yes, go ahead.
If I create a private, I want to publicly, it wants to see. So what I do, any implicit, explicit doing something?
I didn't get your question again.
If I create a private variable.
Now you are creating a private variable. Assume that you are creating private variable string name, okay?
Okay, I want to that access directly into the main function, if any possible way.
Yeah, you need to make it as a public if you want direct access.
Other than public?
No, you cannot. You need to use private itself.
Okay, fine.
Yeah. Why? Because this main design of encapsulation is you should not write field level logic inside your main method as per the principle, design principle. everything you should take inside your Poja class itself. That's why, as the definition, wrapping of data as a single unit, as a methods and variables, to you should not access outside the class.
Like a front function?
Yes, maybe. Yes, exactly. It's a back function. Main method is nothing but is exposing to the user, right? Maybe if you're integrated with the UI, input text box like username, password, right?
Okay.
Whenever you are giving the password, it will give directly, immediately give to your Poja class. Before storing into your database, before storing to your service logic, business logic, everything, it will go and check. First step is a validation. Then only you can do remaining operations. If validation check is failed, your program will be a fail. That's it. Okay. Again, here two ways will be there. UI logic and server-side logic. Basically, we will do both ways. Some user should not give input like some special characters, @, these type of inputs is given. First, UI will be checked. Still, UI side is failed. Then again, I will do my the server side also. Basically, in the real time, both places will do the logic validations as a user input.
Okay.
Assume that same example, now taking as a bank. Now here, I'm creating as a bank, I'm creating double as a balance. Now you see, before setting my balance here, now I can do here, really, before keeping his value, I will do really this customer is related to HDFC, ICIC, whatever it is there, I can do those validation logic here. Add validation logic to check data is correct or not. If before he's fetching the balance, again, I can do your own logic, whatever you need. Now, so that in the bank class, whenever you are setting some balance, now I can check, set balance, I can do some logic, then only I can store my value into a balance variable. Same example, just I'm giving in different way. Is it clear, guys?
Yes.
Encapsulation. Now let me go for few points, theory points. Now try to see what is the advantage providing a variable access via setter and getter method. Basically, what is the advantage means we can validate user given data before storing in the variable. That means we are providing security here. Okay. And so if we given as a negative value is not allowed, so that we can validate given amount value before storing in the bank. Suppose in the bank example, some A class just try to, if you try to pass as a negative value, I can do my authentication, then only I can store the value. This is the advantage. If we provide direct access, suppose as he said, public, if I given, it is not possible to validate given value. Only you need to do in the main method after storing into the variable. I want to do before storing into the variable. So that's why we are doing the encapsulation design. Okay, next. What is the problem if we do not follow encapsulation while designing a class? As you know already, we cannot validate user given data according to the business need. In the future, it will be changed. User programs, it will be a reflect. Based on the customer requirement only, we are able to change, right? Everything. You will get a customer requirement, even if he give every requirement, you need to take it from the customer. Okay, if he given this type of form data, what is the scenario I need to test? What are the test cases? Everything you need to take care as per the requirement. Okay, so this is the problem. So you need to follow and cap. That is why it is one of the OOPS principle. Okay, next. What is the benefit of encapsulation means? Okay, the ability to modify our implemented code without breaking the code of others who using our code. Assume that when I say already your project is running, okay, this is your bank class, this is your balance variable. Assume that maybe in any place, this double I don't want, suppose if I make it as a double in your projects, assume that around 20 places you used your balance variable. Okay. Now future, if I go change to the int, what will happen, guys? Is it breaking throughout the code?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Because
right. Okay. Yeah, maybe done. Instead of the double, let me make it a example here. What I will do? I have one more example. Try to see. I define one more employee here. Let me make it exactly. Why employee 2 is also there? Okay, it is asking to rename my file. Okay. Here I define my integer, my employee ID. You know everyone, ID is an integer. But indirectly, ID you will be seeing in this way, right? Maybe in the real time, it should not be the number. Maybe it will be append based on the company. HCL, maybe 2234, maybe Wipro. Some code will be generated random based on the company requirement. Am I true?
Yes.
This input is really accepting your integer?
No.
No, right? Now, initially while implementing ID means you can do a lot of things. Why? Because company ID means you will use so many places, right? Like ID card access, or if you want to open your company website, everywhere you will use a common code. Your employee ID, they will ask, right? Future, if I change with a string, it will be reflect throughout the code, right? Yes. Am I true? Now here, try to see. Here I'm taking my integer without doing this. Here, I can do it here. Try to see. I'm taking my argument as a string argument, as a input. Then I will try to parse my integer value. Here, I can validate my value. As a user, if he try to give something, I can do, you can convert a string to integer, string to int. Whatever the validation you need, those type of validation, you can do it here. Now, if I execute this program, try to see. I'm getting some exception input string, some name I given here, some random name I'm trying to given here. If I given as my value as a proper value, then there is no problem at all. I will take my input as a string, but internally I'm doing my logic here, integer dot parse it. You can do these type of things. It should, whatever define your data type, by default it will generate as a integer your argument. See, let me make it commented here. Okay. Sorry. Okay. Now let me comment it here. By default, compiler will generate based on your data type. Now let me generate source, generate. I want to generate my setter method. Now generate. Okay, default it will give as integer. Now if you want to, based on your customization, I want to change to my string, no problem at all. Then your ID will be a string. Here you need to parse here to integer value, integer that if you want to convert a string to integer or string to some double or string to the float, whatever you need, we have a method parse int in integer class. If I want to a double, assume that now double dot parse double, then you can provide your ID. In this way, you can provide and add cast to the int. Why? Because my destination data type is int, right? So I need to typecast it here. In this way, you can do the proper validation logic for your encapsulation. Is it clear, guys? So yes. Here, that's why I'm saying without breaking the code of others who using our code, I can modify my code. This is called like a data hiding, one of the benefit and the flexibility. Okay. As a user, I need to restrict for the user. I don't want to provide my setter method. Now I'm giving only I need to fetch the value. Okay. Read access or write access. If you need a read as well as write. Okay, this class has now read access or write access?
Now it's read access.
Only read access. If I provide as a setting method, this is now read as well as write, both.
Right.
Right? So in this way, flexibility we can provide based on the value. Suppose if you take immutable classes, basically immutable class is nothing but you need to provide only the read access. You cannot set the value. Through constructor level only you need to create. Maybe in the strings concept, if I ask to create, how to create immutable class in Java? Assume that all wrapper classes are immutable classes. Okay, you cannot set directly. Through constructor level only you can do that part. Maybe in that, when I explain the strings concept, you will have an idea of the immutability. There you will get a setter method, a read access or set access both. Okay, and a reusability is nothing but same. Now you can add based on the new requirement, and you can add from your code without breaking the existing code. You can utilize wherever you need. Why? Because at last, all your data will be there inside your Pojo class itself only. This Pojo class, you are accessing throughout the project, wherever you need. Even if you want to retrieve from the database, you need your Pojo class. That is the concept came of the ORM, Hibernate related. It is mapped to your Pojo class. If, all values, it will be mapped to your Pojo class so that you can directly play around your objects. This is all about the encapsulation, guys. Is it clear, everything? Even in interview point of, yes.
If you go to that class, Pojo class, why we are defining as integer, not int?
Oh, okay. As of now, I'm giving in the real time, you need to provide int. Why? Because it is specifying a primitive data type. If you provide as an integer, everything is an object. Why we are doing means in the real time, if you are sending your code into a network, maybe chances primitive data types you can modify. If any network security purpose, objects you cannot modify. Why? Because it is specific to the JVM level. So that's why whatever you are doing, these are all like wrapper classes. Integer is a wrapper class of int. There is a difference between the int and integer. By default, some auto boxing concept will be happen for the both. If I made it here, try to see, this is my final class. Basically, it extends my number class. Some values will be happen here. These all classes are like a wrapper classes. And see, inside sometimes you can see here in this way also, implements, serializable and interface they will use. For the network calls, they will convert your whole code into byte stream. Some bytes of data, they will be convert. No one can change. If try to change, they cannot deserialize your class. In few places, you can able to see in this way. Where you will use, as a, you are a client. Suppose Amazon is your client. Now, payment integration. If you want to do payment integration, there is a JSON data will be there. You need to map exactly which attribute you are sending. In that time, they will do all, they will be in the serialization form. You need to deserialize the values. There, you need to use your wrapper classes. You should not use the primitive values. That's why even Java is not 100% pure object-oriented programming language. Pure object programming is nothing but Scala. Some programming language is available. These are 99%. It is a object oriented. Remaining 1%. Why? Because due to the primitive data types is supporting here.
Yeah.
Is it clear?
Yes, I got it.
Okay, it's already 40 minutes. So, can I start abstract class today or tomorrow? Can I start?
I think it's better to start tomorrow itself.
Yeah, then I will start abstract class by tomorrow. This is all about the encapsulation. Try to practice, try to see in your project. We have a less than a minute, so it will be disconnect immediately. So that's why I'm informing guys.